Yeah, now let's focus on the valuation ratios. The valuation ratios are primarily to do with the market price. Right, I am more bothered about the market price in the computation of the valuation ratios. So I would like to take their market price and then see, and same thing I have to do with the competitors also. So it's purely based on the market price of the company. So let's say I'll take the market prices. So I'll take the market prices. Okay. So the 2007, no, I don't need. I need from 2008, or probably actually 2007 only is required, because 2008 March. So the mostly it's the 2007 data that is required for me. Right. So I'll take this price as 213.9. The stock price. So I'll take the stock price here, 213.9 in this year. Then I'll take the next year is 250.25, 264.75, 312.3. See, that's what I was telling you, right? Only 407.8 by the end of 2011. Right, 407.8, but now within the last 6, 7, 8 months, they have grown almost by 20% or 25%, or probably even from this year, another 100 jump, another 100 jump. Which one? No, it's a closing price. The high price is this one. The 52 weeks high is this one. The end of 2011 year, this is the closing price. So somewhere 312, 407. See, I mean, by the end of 2011, the last trade of 2011, it was a 407.8. The highest in 2011, it has gone up to 420. Whereas in 2012, it has already touched 504. So that's the kind of growth that is coming in the last 2 years. Almost 25% constant growth each year. Right? Okay, now once I have these numbers, I can compute the market capitalization in each of the years. Market capitalization will give me as price multiplied by number of shares. So I'll take this as, this is the price multiplied by number of shares we have computed somewhere here. This is the number of shares. So the market capitalization of the company is 46,000 crores in that year, 2008. Now it has gone to 88,000 crores. So, simpler way of putting it is, if at all someone has to buy all the equity of this company, they have to pay around 88,000 crores to buy all the equity as per that market price. But today, if I take the today's market price, it would be much more higher, because today it has already touched 502 or something. So, that 502, if I put, it would be much more higher. Right, but this ratio, for what purpose I will use? I will use it as the, there are few ratios which I am computing from this to see whether it is overpriced or underpriced. For price to book value, we have done one. So the price to book value is nothing but market capitalization divided by book value, which is nothing but the shareholders' funds. So we see here, this is the market capitalization divided by the shareholders' funds coming from the balance sheet. You see 32 rupees, 32 times. Now today it has come to 21 times. So initially it was very highly overvalued. Compared to these 2 years, things are slightly better here. So the first 2 years there is a high overvalue. Price to book value. Okay, so this is one ratio. Again, I compare it with the competitors, industry. The higher these ratios, all valuation ratios, which are more to do with market price, and where the price is there in the numerator. You see, there are a lot of ratios where price is there in the numerator. Wherever price is there in the numerator, the higher the price is, or the higher the ratio is, I call it as undervalued, the overvalued, and the lesser the ratio is, it becomes undervalued. So with respect to the past, it is undervalued, so better buying. But with respect to competitors and industry also, I have to check it out before I take a conclusion about its buying, right? So the same logic goes with price to earnings. So, this is also like market cap divided by PAT. So, what this is a very interesting ratio. Market cap divided by PAT. What this is saying is, for every 24 rupees which the investor paid to buy the share in the market, the company has generated 1 rupee profit. For every 24 rupees the investor paid to buy the share in the market, not in the company, in the secondary market. For every 24 rupees the investor paid to buy the share in the secondary market, the company generated 1 rupee profit. So, the percentage wise, almost it is 1/24 percentage profit. The company has generated 1/24, which is just 4% profit with respect to the investors buying the share in the stock market. The company has generated only a yield of 4%. This is the true picture, right? It has nothing to do with the book value or anything. The investor has bought the share at some amount, right? So, for every 24 rupees he has paid, the company generated 1 rupee of profit. Whereas, so which means, the lesser the ratio is, the better is the percentage of profit. Right, now if I see this recently, for every 32 rupees, the company generated 1 rupee profit. Clear mention of overvalue. See, for every 32 rupees you have invested, you are getting 1 rupee profit. And whether the company pays that dividend or not, it's immaterial. The profit is only 1 rupee. Out of that, it will pay half a rupee as a dividend. So, it's like for 32 rupees of your investment, you are getting 1 rupee as a profit. Even if the company pays or doesn't pay, let's not bother about it. Because if it does not pay, it will grow for next year. But profit generation is important. So, 32 rupees of your buying the share in the stock market, 1 rupee the company, so it's like you have invested 32 rupees and you have got 1 rupee as the profit. Are you ready for that investment? Right? The higher you invest, so probably even if you have invested 100 rupees, probably it would have generated 3 rupees as the profit. 3% is your profit. Probably you put the money in a bank deposit, you will get much more. Correct? So 3% profit is not a desirable stuff. So the logic is the P by E ratio should be as much lesser as possible. So all valuation ratios should be as much lesser as possible to enable a person to buy them. So I have to compare it with my competitors also. If they are pretty less, then this is already overvalued. Better target the others. Then similarly, I will look at price to capital employed. Capital employed includes both debt as well as equity capital. So in this case, the company's case, there is nothing much of debt. So market cap by debt plus equity. In this case, there is nothing much of a difference to price equity ratio, price to earning ratio, because the debt is almost zero for this company. So market cap divided by the debt. So this is equity plus debt. Only first 2 years there is some debt. After that there is no debt, which means after that the price to capital employed versus price to book value will remain the same. These 3 years, the price to book value and price to capital employed is the same because debt is zero. Wherever debt exists to some extent. So all these things are saying the price is much more compared to what is invested in the company. So book value is what is really invested in the company. Market value is what is the price people are buying it in the market. So, the real investment in the company is 18 rupees, whereas people are buying it at 500 rupees. That's where the number is very, very high. Right? Now, that's what. For every 1 rupee that is invested into the company, so the 1 rupee is invested in the company. But in the secondary market, it is available for 32 rupees. 32 times what is actually invested in the company is what is sold in the market. So, because it's a trading, in trading, it is available 32 times of its real investment in the market. Right? See, logically put, at the time of IPO, the price and book value will not be much different. They both will be the same. As the days move forward, because of the demand and supply, the market price may go much above the book value. Now it has gone to such an extent, it has become 32 times that of the book value. So the more and more it is going up, there is a chance that the more and more it is going up, there is a chance that it will fall down. Right?
So, for 1 rupee of the capital that is employed in the company's core business, that is costing you 32 rupees.
In the market. Then, similarly, we are looking at price to the sales ratio, which is more talking of market cap divided by the sales. Market cap divided by the sales. Where? Again the same logic. For every 1 rupee that the investor has bought the share in the market, how many rupees of sales the company is doing? So if the amount the investor has invested is very high compared to what the company is selling as sale, it's already paid. This guy is paying a high price. So, this is nothing but market cap divided by sales. Market cap divided by sales. So, what it is saying is, the investor has invested, bought the share for 4 rupees. The company is able to sell only for 1 rupee. right? So if the or the other way to put it is, for every 1 rupee of selling the company is doing, the investor is paying 4 rupees to purchase that share. Company is actually doing a selling of 1 rupee, but the investor is paying 4 rupees to purchase it. So he is paying a premium to purchase it heavily. Not about profit, it's only about sales. For every 1 rupee the company is able to sell, the investor is paying 4 rupees to purchase it in the market. Again, if you see, this has gone up. The higher it is means it's already overvalued. I have to compare again with my competitors and the industry average. Right? So that is the selling price wise. So that will cost, that is more like a cost. I mean, that is the profit to the company. Here we are talking of buying the share in the stock market. You are paying very heavy. See, this 1 rupee is the sale itself. The company is selling for 1 rupee. Whereas when you are buying the share in the market, you are paying 4 rupees, or probably it's like this. If I assume that whatever you are buying the shares is going to the company, 4 rupees of your investment is resulting in 1 rupee of sales. What is happening to your 3 rupees? Probably the crude way of analyzing that, 4 rupees of your investment is resulting only in 1 rupee of your sale. What is happening to that 3 rupees? Which means you have unnecessarily given the 3 rupees. Right? See, whatever you invest, it has to result into sales. If sales has to grow, then it's good you investing more and more in the company. Question mark. Not even reserves and surplus. That's not reserves and surplus. See, you have invested 4. The company is able to sell only for 1 rupee. The 3 rupees, it does not know what to do. Right? Because your 502 or 4 rupees is not going to the company. For the company, it's not a problem. The 4 rupees is going to your someone who has sold you the share. Right? But you have to really look at, am I paying more or less? The ratio, the higher it is, I am saying you are paying more. Right? You compare it with your competitors and industry average, which will clearly tell you if you are paying more or less. Then, ratios are good. See, that's where, they might have already been captured in the market. The ratios are good. The company is performing well. That has already been captured as a part of the buying. So, people have already bought and they have increased the share price already. Now, if you decide whether I should buy, it may be a wrong time. It has already gone to a high price. Now you will observe that the price will go down. The numbers wise, if you have to work on it, that is where the modeling and valuation will come up. But as far as the ratios wise are concerned, we are looking at, all the other ratios are good. Typically, the company has good prospect. ROE is very high. So it's worth investing in it. That's the reason the stock price has gone from 407 to 502 already. Right? Because so, whatever the financial result released in March 2012, this is already we are at July or August 2012. So, in 4-5 months, people have already bought the shares and the price has already gone up. Today, if I take that decision, now you take the today's price and do this. Why that old price? The today's price is 502. So, look at this number 502 divided by the PAT are probably, so if I take it as 502, the market capitalization will become this multiplied by number of shares. This is what is the market capitalization. Now you divide this market capitalization by PAT 40.3. You are almost, I mean, earlier last year itself you were at 32. Now you have gone to 40. Look at your industry average. If it is at around 20, probably you are much, much overvalued. You cannot, I mean, now you cannot think that it will grow beyond 40. People have spent that from 32, it has gone to 40 because of the performance this year. Now, until I get a new performance of the company, I cannot think it will go to 45 also. Because it has already been reflected. So, probably again in the next March or April, when they release their new annual report, if I expect that there is a, if I see that there is a, all the other ratios are even more better compared to the previous year, then again it will grow up. So, at that time I buy, it will even increase. Right? Sorry? Yeah, yeah. Now you can go for a sell recommendation. So, similarly, I can do with cash flows. The market cap divided by the cash flow. So, what this is saying for us is, for every 30 rupees you have invested in the company or invested to buy the share, or I think we have to do it from this year. Because the first year we did not have the cash flow. We made the cash flow from the second year. So, 35, for every 35 rupees you paid to buy the share, company has generated a cash of 1 rupee. Now it is even more worse. You pay for every 565 rupees you paid to buy the share, the company is generating cash of 1 rupee. Profit wise it may be generating more, but real cash wise it is generating 1 rupee for every 565 rupees. Kind of overvaluing again itself. So in all these valuation ratios, the focus is always on, the higher the number is, because all of them will have price in the numerator. So, the higher the number is, the overvalued they are, and we generally go for a sell recommendation on that. The lesser the number is, we go for a buy recommendation. So, this has to be again comparison with respect to past, with respect to industry average, and with respect to the competition. Then only addition. So, this is a, there is nothing like a science like this is the number, so this should be the buy or sell. Because some of them may show high, some of them may show low. It's all about your clubbing of the things. It's all about your experience in that. Your, whether you are getting consistent profits by giving this kind of a recommendation or not. So, each person or each security has its own flavor. Right, there is nothing like, see, if it is a science and if I know that this is the mantra, then probably nothing else is required. I will always be profitable. So, the stock markets do not allow person to get that. So, it's just up to this point we can do. And after that, how do I take a decision is again my subjective matter. Right, because one ratio may show overvalued, another ratio may show undervalued. Now, which I have to use, this is not a flow chart that if this is greater than this, follow this, otherwise this. This is not a flow chart or a science. Now, all of them you take, based on that you take a decision. Right? Sometimes some people may just focus on two numbers. You just go and ask to any broker, he'll say, I'll look only at P by E. P by E increases, sell. P by E decreases, buy. Those are again, those are your, what you call, the technical short-term investment. No, that's where I am saying. Everyone has his own style. At the end, if I am profitable, I am great. If I am not profitable, I am worse. Right? So, there is a different angle. So, all these, the more I learn, the more I complicate also sometimes. Right? And, but it gives a kind of support. Now, if I use 4 or 5 different methods, and in all 4 or 5 of them, it is saying buy. Probably it looks like a strong buy. Because different methods developed through different algorithms, different processes, all of them are saying buy. Probably then better go for a buy. At least some profit or other you will make. If 2 of them are selling buy, 2 of them are selling sell, probably be neutral. So that way, knowing various methods will help from that perspective. Sometimes 2 buy, 2 sell still may be profitable also. So that's again something which an individual has to take as a decision. Right? Similarly, this is just a number, net sales per share. So where I am looking at sales divided by the total number of shares. So for every share, what is the, this is not a good ratio at all. Nothing much in this. No big interpretation. Net sales per no total number. So for every share, the company is able to sell 62 rupees. So 62 rupees of sales the company is selling. Out of this, or probably here if I say, for every share, the company is selling 102 rupees, making a profit of 12.45 rupees, giving a dividend of 7.5 rupees. This is the linkage. For every share that has been there in the company, it is doing a sales worth 102 rupees. It is doing a sales worth of 102 rupees, generating a profit of 12.45 rupees and giving a dividend of 7.5 rupees. Right? And yeah, if I have to talk about the sustainable growth rate, I'll introduce one more field. Sustainable growth rate comes out as ROE into retained earning or retention ratio. Because if I am retaining some amount of my profit, that is actually contributing to the growth. So people will compute the growth percentage as retention ratio multiplied by the ROE. So probably first year you can ignore. The later year, this year I can say the company can grow next year by almost 26.5%. That's a sustainable growth rate for the next year. Right? The company can grow at 26.5%. So for next year, if some kind of projection has to be made, I can very well assume that the numbers will grow up by 26.5%. Right? So this is one more way of computing the sustainable growth rate of the company.